citizens of Ayodhya, the family members of Lord Ramchandra, for 14 years lived in separation. In those days, there was no television, newspapers, internet, text messaging, cellular phones, or any type of phones. When the citizens of Ayodhya went to Chitrakoot, headed by Bharat, although it broke their hearts to see Ram and Lakshman with matted hair and tree bark, and seeing the most delicate, elegant Sita living in a straw hut wearing tree bark, it broke their hearts. But still, even when they refused to return, they knew that the ultimate and only true objects of their love were in a peaceful, beautiful place on the banks of the Mandakini River in Chitrakoot. In the company of some of the greatest yogis and sages and rishis in all the world. But then certainly news came to them that they left Chitrakoot for the Dandakaranya forest. And in Panchavati, Ravana stole Sita. Ram and Lakshman were traveling throughout eastern, southern India, part of western India, searching and searching. So they really didn't know where Ram and Sita were. There was no news. There was only the longing of their hearts for them to return. On this day of Diwali, Ram sent a message through Hanumanji that he would return to Ayodhya. The 14 years of exile have expired. Lord Sri Ramchandra fulfilled the mission that he promised the demigods that he would do by descending into the world. He liberated Mother Earth and all of her children from the exploitative, cruel Ravana. And along with Sita, Lakshman, and all of his devotees headed by Hanuman, Jambavan, Sugriva, in the Pushpaka, the beautiful chariot of Kuvera, he was coming back to Ayodhya. Pushpaka arrived in Nandigram, where Bharat was living as a hermit in a little straw hut, wearing only tree bark, with his hair matted, eating the simplest of all foods. For 14 years, he had placed Lord Ram's wooden shoes, padukas, on the throne and he ruled the citizens. He ruled the whole kingdom by performing all the duties without accepting any of the comforts. But he lived as Ram and Lakshman and Sita did in the forest. The citizens of Ayodhya, absolutely thrilled. It was the ultimate festival of all festivals to welcome Ram, Sita, Lakshman back to their homes. As Ram was coming, he saw the citizens of Ayodhya in the night. They lit lamps, little fire lamps, some little, some bigger. All the citizens had lit their little lamps as an offering of their love to welcome Ram home. And this is Diwali. The principle is that each and every one of our hearts is Krishna's home, or Ram's home, Sita's home. But due to darkness, the darkness of ignorance, ignorance in the sense of forgetfulness of our true nature and what our real purpose of life is, we allow the ahankar, the false ego, to keep us in the darkness of limitless misconceptions, which give rise to so many fears and desires, attractions and aversions. Not just 14 years, but since time immemorial, for countless lifetimes, we have lived in such a condition. Bhakti is to light the lamp of our devotion, our love, to welcome Krishna, Sri Radha, or in this case, Ram and Sita, back home into our hearts. Back home, back to Godhead. That home is within us. But we have forgotten. It's never lost. It's simply forgotten. Like a person who has an enormous treasury but forgets where it is, the person suffers in poverty. But as soon as is reminded by modern day analogy, if you have a bank account with hundreds of millions of rupees, but you forget your bank account number, and you don't know anybody who knows it, you're living in desperation, you're starving, you're in poverty, you're doing all kinds of things, stealing and exploiting and enduring so much bad karma just to somehow or other try to survive and enjoy and alleviate your suffering. But actually your wealth is there. You just forgot where it is. Similarly, we are seeking, trying to find our wealth, our happiness in money, in fame, in sensual pleasures, even in health and all of these things. These things can all be used for a very divine purpose. But the purpose is only divine when we understand what our real wealth is. It's at home, within our own hearts. Bhakti is that light, that lamp that lights our hearts. Bhakti mam abhijanati yavan yashasmi tatvata. Krishna said, it is only through such bhakti, through the light of love, that I can be understood as I am. Because Krishna is the husband of the goddess of fortune. He's the controller and proprietor of everything that exists, and he's Atma Rama. He's completely self-satisfied. He does not need any of the temporary objects of this world. But he's Bhakta Vatsal. He's attracted by love. And even a simple little leaf or flower or a little water, if it's offered with love, Krishna will consider that to be more precious than all the treasury of kings. In a few days, we'll be going to Udupi. There is, in the Udupi Krishna temple, a painting on the wall. That painting depicts a very special pastime where Narada Muni came to Dwaraka and was going to take Krishna away with him. And the queens of Dwaraka, headed by Satyabhama, they were pleading, don't take Krishna away. Krishna is the ultimate supreme wealth. So it was arranged that Krishna would sit on a scale. In those days, the scales were two ends and weights would balance each other. And Narada Muni said, if you put your most precious jewelry, the weight of Krishna, then you can have Krishna and I will take the jewels. So Krishna sat on one end of the scale. And Satyabrahma brought all our jewelry. And the scale didn't move. Then all the other queens started bringing enormous amount of jewelry. There was a huge pile on the other side of the scale. And still, Krishna outweighed it all. Krishna's heavier than the heaviest. But if he wishes, he's lighter than the lightest. Rukmini came, and she saw what was happening because it was really a crisis. Krishna was going to leave. So Rukmini had all the jewels taken off. And she took a single tulsi leaf and put it to her heart. And with a humble, prayerful mood, she chanted Krishna's names with love. There was nothing else on the scale. She placed that single leaf. And Krishna flew up to the top. Krishna wanted to show that there is no greater wealth and there's nothing else he wants except the simplicity of our love and devotion. The citizens of Ayodhya, they had great wealth. But Ram didn't need any of that. They all offered a little lamp of their love to light the way for him back home, into the home of their hearts. And for us, this is what Diwali means. When we offer our lamp, it's not just offering fire. Krishna really doesn't need fire. He's Surya Narayan. He's the controller of the sun planet. The sun is millions of times bigger than the earth, and it's fire. Does he need our little lamp? But yet Surya Narayan is conquered by a little flame this big if it's offered with love. Godhead is light. So Diwali was the great time when all the citizens of Ayodhya welcome Ram back home to Ayodhya, back home into their hearts. It's one of the greatest, most beautiful celebrations historically, from the time of Treta Yuga. And the same principle of Prema Pumartha Mahan, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu explained, the greatest perfection is Prema, divine love for Krishna. That is the story of Damodar Lila, which was also enacted on this day. In Gokul, Vrindavan, while everyone was preparing to celebrate Diwali in a very beautiful way, Yashoda Mai, she rose very early in the morning because, according to Srimad Bhagavatam and many of the Acharya's writings, Krishna, as soon as he learned how to walk with his friends, began their pastimes of stealing butter from the homes of the gopis. And the gopis would come. It's interesting how people in India celebrate Diwali with so many fireworks. Doesn't sound like Ram coming back to Ayodhya. Sounds like the Battle of Sri Lanka. Kali Yuga, everything is mixed up. It's not going to stop either. Krishna wants us to adjust to the circumstances and carry on with our devotional service. This is a principle. We cannot always That was a good one. We cannot always change the circumstances, but we could always adjust our consciousness. Tamstha Dikshasva Bharata. Matras Parashastha Konteya Sitosna Sukadukana Agamapayano Nityas Tamstha Dikshasva Bharata. Krishna tells that in this world there are always dualities. there's always changes. And oftentimes, we just have no power to change the environment. But our real success in life is how we sustain our spirit of seva, of service and devotion. We sustain the faithfulness and loyalty of our integrity and our sadhana, whatever may come. Sita remained totally faithful to Ram, 24 hours a day remembering Ram, whether she was sitting beside him on the throne of Ayodhya, whether she was walking through the darkest, most dangerous forests barefoot, or even when she was surrounded by Rakshasis and being threatened cruelly by Ravana. Ravana could not defeat her because he could not take away her will to serve Ram, to please Ram. And that's really our success. Everyone has to die. So some people think that what's the use of becoming a devotee? You still have to get sick and you still have to die. But that's only the body. The real victory of a devotee is in life and death, in happiness and distress, honor, dishonor, pleasure and pain, victory, defeat, health or disease, in life or in death. We adjust ourselves and remember Krishna. And the simplest way of remembering God is to remember the name of God by chanting Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna So as the fireworks and the bombs explode, we will try to carry on talking about this very sweet Damodar Lila. Why does Krishna steal butter? Actually, Krishna doesn't steal butter. Because a thief is usually one who takes somebody else's property. Krishna is Sarva Loka Maheshwaram. Krishna is the proprietor of everything that exists. All the worlds, all living beings is Krishna's property. Nothing is ours. Whether we're rich or poor or whatever in between, we understand whatever we have, our intelligence, our abilities, our property, our wealth, they are all entrusted in our care. And we could utilize it for a divine purpose and attain the highest liberation, or we could use it on so many other levels of material consciousness and entangle ourselves in complexities of life. So Krishna's not stealing because it's his. But yet, he is Makanchor. He's the butter thief. Because when our heart becomes soft and sweet like fresh butter, Krishna, who is Hari, he steals our hearts. That is bhakti. So the residents of Vrindavan, their only desire was to make Krishna happy. And in order to exchange the most intimate pastimes of affection with his devotees. Krishna covered his supremacy and appeared like a little child. In his Bal Lila, he's a baby. He's crawling. When he's only a day or 2 years old, he is killing Putana, who is more powerful than all the armies on earth. And Krishna effortlessly just squeezed her and sucked her. And he did it in such a way that nobody even thought he was strong. They just thought he was a baby, and somehow or other, God must have saved him. When he was only a year old and Trinavarta took him high into the sky, he became heavier than the earth. And Trinavarta came crashing down to the ground. And then he crawled into Yashodamayi's arms and the other gopis. And they would just toss him in the air like a little feather. And he would laugh and smile, and they would toss him and catch him and toss him and catch him. Just like I see you mothers do with your babies. So Krishna appeared so ordinary, so that he could be loved with intimacy. The love of a mother for a child, a friend for a friend, or a lover for a beloved is much deeper and sweeter than the love for an almighty master. And it is in Vrindavan that Krishna gives the facility for the most intimate pastimes of love. In Vrindavan, Krishna learns how to walk. He's the ability for all of us. And Nanda Maharaj is teaching Krishna how to walk. He's holding out his little finger. And little child Krishna's holding onto his finger. And Nanda Maharaj is saying, come, come, walk. And Krishna takes a few steps, and then he falls down and starts crying. Nanda Maharaj says, please try again, hold on to my finger. He falls down and cries. And Nanda Maharaj's heart is flooding over with affection. He's my child. The same love that the great denizens of Vaikuntha have for Narayan is there, but so much deeper and sweeter with Nanda and Yashoda, who are loving Krishna as their little child. And actually, all the older gopis and gopas are loving Krishna in the same way. And as soon as he learned to walk, he and Balaram and his friends would go to the houses to steal butter from gopis. And the gopis would come to complain to Yashodamayi in so many ways. But actually, their complaining was not complaining. It was glorification. It was Krishna Katha. Because it was so pleasing to them that Krishna was coming to their houses, because they only made their butter for one reason, so that Krishna would come to take it. If Krishna didn't come to take it, they were longing and praying, Gopal, come. And then when he would come, he would do it in such a way that they would complain. But in complaining, it was Harikatha. They were speaking, they were glorifying, they were remembering. So on the day of, there's many stories. Krishna would even steal butter from Yashodamayi. In the Ananda Brindavan Champu, it tells how Krishna was stealing and eating butter. And he happened to see, he was just a little tiny child. Next to him was a jeweled pillar. And in the inlaid jewels, he saw a reflection of himself. And he got scared. He told the little boy in the reflection, "Don't tell my mother what I'm doing." He said, "If you don't tell my mother, I will share the butter with you, and you will enjoy it very, very much." And his mother, Yashoda, in a hiding place, was watching the whole thing. With great happiness, she was smiling. And then she came out, and Krishna, very much afraid, he said, "I'm not stealing butter, I'm not stealing butter." He said, "Actually, that," he pointed to the reflection of himself in the pillar. He said, "He's stealing the butter. I told him not to do it. I told him that I would be very angry with him if he steals butter, but he stole it anyway, and I'm very angry with him, but I'm not stealing butter." Another time, Yashodamai went outside and Krishna's hand was in butter pot. And as soon as Krishna saw Yashodamai, he said, "I'm not stealing butter." He said, "Actually, because his hand's in the pot." He said, "You put these bangles, these bracelets on me. And the bracelets have ruby jewels, and they're so hot, they're burning my hand. I can't tolerate it. I put my hand in just to cool it off." And Yashodamai smiled, and she put little Gopal on her lap and embraced him and looked at his wrist. And she said, "Oh, just see how your wrist is all burnt. I will take the bangles off and not put them on anymore." Sweetness of their love. And Krishna would go to gopis' houses and he would always escape. Sometimes he would be eating their butter and they would come to catch him so that they could take him to Yashodamai and say, "You see, it's true. You don't believe us. He is stealing our butter." But as soon as they would come to catch Krishna, he would smile at them. And they would enter into a state of such deep ecstasy, they couldn't move. They just stood there like paralyzed in transcendental bliss. And right in front of their eyes, Krishna would just eat all their butter. But one time, one of Krishna's aunts, in India, you say auntie. She actually caught Krishna. Krishna's little child. She said, "I'm going, Yashodamai never believes us. But today I caught you and there's butter all over you. I'm going to bring you to your mother and then she's going to know what you do." Then little Gopal looked at her, very innocent, but very firm. He said, "I warn you. Do not bring me to my mother." She said, "I'm going to bring you now." He said, "I warned you." She pulled little Gopal. And she had Gopal holding his hand. And she said to Yashodamai, "You see, your Gopal, I caught him. There's butter all over him. You see, I caught him. He denies it. You don't believe, but you see, I caught him." And Yashodamai looked at her and says, "I don't understand what you're talking about." She said, "I have your son, look." She said, "I don't understand what you're saying." She said, "Look." And she looked down. To her surprise, it wasn't Krishna. It was her own son. She was really bewildered. So she walked away with her son, and she was walking down the road, and then she heard some laughter. And she looked down, and in her hand was Krishna. And Krishna said, I warned you. You see how embarrassed you were? He said, if you do this again, next time I will manifest myself as your husband. So the gopis used to come and they would tell so many incredibly sweet pastimes of what Krishna would do. And Yashoda Mai would say, then I will somehow keep Krishna at home. And they said, no, don't do that. They loved Krishna to come to take their butter. He was accepting their love. So on the day of Diwali, Mother Yashoda, she sent all of her assistants, she's Brajeshwari, to perform other duties. And she decided to rise very early while Gopal was still sleeping to personally churn the yogurt, the dahi, herself. Her idea was she grew special kinds of grass. It was called Padmaganda. It was sweet and fragrant. She watered the grass with the best of the cow's milk. And that grass was so intoxicatingly fragrant. And she had the very, very best. Nanda Maharaj had 900,000 cows. Among them, there was 108. Among them was 8. Among them was 2. And they were the ones that had their milk, because they only took this particular type of grass. And they were loved so dearly that it was the ultimate sweetest milk. And it was with that milk that she made yogurt, dahi, and she was churning it with her own hands, with her own personal heart's motherly love. And as she was churning, she was singing sweet songs about Krishna. And Srila Prabhupada quotes from the previous acharyas and Shukadeva Goswami that in Vrindavan, this was one of the ways that everybody was always remembering Krishna. Whatever he did, they would make a festival for it. If the wind made his cloth go up a little, they would make a festival. And they would compose songs. Everything he did was so special. Every little detail, every raising of his eyebrow, every smile of his lips, everything was celebrated with so much love. When the gopas would come home after herding the cows later with Krishna or the calves, they would sing beautiful songs about what Krishna did that day. And the whole next day, the elderly gopas and gopis would compose more and more poetry and songs just to remind each other of what Krishna did the day before. In this way, there was constant kirtan in Vrindavan. Golokera premadana harinam sankirtan. That this kirtan has descended from the highest realm of the spiritual world. It's eternal pastimes of the most loving, elevated devotees, the eternal associates of the Lord. So as Yashoda Mai was singing songs about Krishna's beautiful form, his characteristics, qualities, and childlike pastimes, she was keeping rhythm as she was churning. The bangles or the bracelets on her wrists were making sounds like tff, tff, keeping rhythm. And the sound of the churning rod in the yogurt was making different types of rhythmic musical annotations. And as she was singing, beautiful flowers that were decorating her hair were falling. And remembering Krishna, so much motherly love was awakening in her heart. And it manifested with the milk of her love coming out from her breasts as an offering to Krishna. Krishna was in the next room sleeping. But Krishna's always hungry for the sweetness of his devotee's love. As that milk was flowing, Krishna woke up hungry to receive it, to reciprocate with that love. So he ran to where his mother was churning, and with one hand, he held the churning rod and said, "No more churning." And he climbed on her lap, and she began to feed him her milk. And as she was feeding little Gopal, she was looking at his face, his eyes were like lotus petals. His nose was like a sesame flower. His lips were fresh like and red like the bimba fruit. His face was round like the moon, with the most enchanting complexion, like a monsoon rain cloud. And around his moon-like face was beautiful, beautiful hair, like silk, curling around his face. He looked so helpless, so innocent, so supremely lovable. And as she gazed upon him with tears of ecstasy in her eyes, the milk flowed as Krishna drank it. Suddenly, she heard. She was boiling some milk for Krishna for later in the day, and it was boiling over. This was the Pushpaganda milk, Padmaganda milk. Padmaganda is that precious milk that's special for Krishna. So she wanted to save it. So she placed Krishna down and ran to the kitchen. Krishna bit his lower lip with his upper teeth because he was angry. His lips were red, his teeth was white. Krishna was giving the world a good lesson that the way we control the passion of anger, because Rajaguna is characterized by the red color, like the lips. And Sattvaguna is characterized by the white color, like the teeth. So Krishna wanted to show that we control our anger, we control Rajaguna with Sattvaguna. This was why we're given these regulative principles. We can control our lower modes by learning how to live in the mode of goodness. And the Srimad Bhagavatam says, from the mode of goodness, we could actually transcend the modes of nature. Through bhakti or devotional service, from the platform when we come to the mode of goodness, living with character, honesty, humility, integrity, when we engage in the loving service of the Lord without expecting anything selfish in return, then we transcend the modes of nature forever and attain the highest liberation. But Krishna was doing it as an act of transcendental anger. He took a stone which was used for grinding spices, and he cracked the clay pot that the yogurt was being churned. It spread out on the floor, and then Krishna went to another room. Yashoda Mai came back, and she saw the pot was cracked, the yogurt was on the floor, and she knew that Krishna had done it. So she followed the little buttery footprints of Krishna into a courtyard where she saw, and she was watching from a hidden place, Krishna had piled a wood grinding mortar, and he was standing on top of it to reach butter and yogurt that were hanging from the ceiling, from ropes, and he was feeding it to the monkeys. According to some acharyas, Hanuman, Sugriva, all of these great, Shushena, Nila, Nala, so many of these monkeys, there were many. They risked their lives to build that bridge across the Indian Ocean. They searched, even enduring hunger and thirst, to find Sita. They fought an entire battle. And Ram was living in the forest. He never gave them anything in return. He just accepted their love. That's all they wanted. But he was feeling indebted. So he called those monkeys to appear like monkeys in Vrindavan. This was his spirit. Come, let me give you this fresh butter that was churned by my mother. And they were all coming, and could you imagine how happy those monkeys were? Taking butter from Krishna's hands. There was a festival. All the monkeys were eating and jumping and chattering. And Krishna was giving them more and more and more. Yashoda Mai, she took a little stick because she wanted to teach Krishna a little lesson. As a mother, she's thinking, if I don't teach Krishna, how will he ever learn? And meanwhile, Krishna, because he knew he was doing something naughty, Yashoda Mai saw Krishna looking. His little eyes, beautiful lotus eyes, they were darting in different directions, and he was turning in fear that he would be caught by his mother. And as Yashoda Mai came close to him, the monkeys started going, and the crows that were coming in trying to get some butter too, they saw Yashoda Mai, and they started cawing and flying around, and Krishna looked behind him, and there was Yashoda Mai with a stick. Krishna jumped off the grinding mortar to run away. Yashoda Mai ran after him. Krishna ran and Yashoda ran. As she was running, it's impossible to catch the supreme absolute truth. But Yashoda Mai caught him. Krishna willingly accepted being caught by his mother because he wanted to show the world that he is subordinate to the love of his devotee by his own sweet will. When we say God is great, there are so many levels of understanding that. Yes, God is the supreme creator of everything that exists. Yes, God by his mere will can destroy everything that exists. The controller of all controllers.
But the greatest of all the greatness of God is he has conquered and willingly accepts subordination to intimate love. That is Krishna Lila. Now Yashoda Maya is holding Krishna with one hand and she's holding a stick in the other. And Satyavrat Muni, he's explaining in this beautiful song, the Damodarastakam, Krishna was trembling. His lips were quivering. He had black ointment, kajal, on his eyes, and his eyes were crying in fear. And he was rubbing his eyes, and the black mascara was flowing down his face. Such a beautiful sight. And he said to his mother, yes, I stole the butter. I broke the pots. I did it. Please put down that stick. I'm very afraid.
Like that. Queen Kunti offers this prayer that although Krishna is feared by fear personified, he's afraid of his mother. Abhaya Charana Ravindare, one who takes shelter of Krishna, becomes fearless forever. But Krishna's afraid of his mother. That fear is the greatest opulence. It's the ornamentation that makes Krishna supremely attractive to his devotees. So Yashoda Mai throws the stick away. And she didn't want to punish Krishna, but it was her feeling that she had so many duties to perform for Krishna's service that day, and Krishna was such a naughty child doing such naughty things today, she was afraid he may run away from home and get in all kinds of trouble and dangers. So to protect Krishna with her motherly love, she took a very soft, smooth rope to put it around his waist, to tie him to the grinding mortar. But when she placed it around his waist, when she went to tie it, it was the width of two fingers too short. So she took another rope and tied it to that. When she went to put it around Krishna's little waist, it was two fingers too short. She got more and more rope. And no matter how much rope she got, all the rope in her house, it was still the same distance too short. And the other gopis, when they heard about this and saw this, it was so beautiful. They were all laughing and smiling and singing Krishna's glories, and so many gopis were bringing all the rope from their houses. It was a festival of ropes of all different colors and all different sizes. There were hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of meters of rope being tied together. And every time Yashoda Mai put it around Krishna's waist, it was the width of two fingers too short. The incredible thing about this pastime, and there are so many dimensions of inconceivable beauty, but Krishna's waist was not growing. A rope that was 2 feet in length could have easily tied against him. And now there were hundreds and hundreds of meters, thousands of meters of rope tied together. Krishna's waist was not growing. The rope was not shrinking. But it was always the width of two fingers too short. Yashoda Mai was perspiring, the flowers were falling from her hair.
And some of the gopis, they were all just laughing and smiling, and they said, Yashoda Mai, it seems that it's not Krishna's destiny to be tied up today. And Yashoda Mai said, but I have to protect my child. He's so naughty. I don't know what trouble he'll get into unless I tie him. And besides that, I'm really curious to see how much rope it takes to go around the waist of my little Gopal. And Gopal, by his own sweet will, allowed Yashoda Mai to tie him with a knot to the grinding mortar. So many contradictions are apparently within this story. Krishna is the controller of all controllers. He's the source of Mahavishnu. All the devas or demigods get their power from Krishna. But yet he's controlled by his mother's love. In the Upanishads, it describes that the absolute truth, the Paramatma, is faster than the fastest. Faster than the speed of wind, faster than the speed of mind, can never be caught. Even the greatest yogis and jnanis, they cannot catch the supreme absolute truth. Even by lifetimes and lifetimes of tapasya and penance and acquisition of transcendental knowledge. But yet that supreme absolute truth is the source of the Paramatma, whose bodily rays forms the Brahma Jyoti or the Brahman effulgence. Is caught by a simple gopi, Yashoda, by her love. Although Krishna is feared by fear personified, he's trembling in fear of his mother. And although he has infinite hundreds and thousands of goddesses of fortune serving him, he's stealing to eat something, like somebody who's in poverty. This beautiful story is a testimony that the greatest power in all of creation is prem, because it is the only power that attracts the all-attractive Krishna. The name Krishna means all-attractive, because he possesses all strength, all beauty, all knowledge, all wealth, all fame and all renunciation. But Krishna is attracted by the simple, sweet love of the heart. Hanuman was a monkey. Yashoda Mai was just a simple gopi. The little squirrel that we'll talk about tomorrow was just a little tiny animal. Every single one of us, whoever we are, whatever our race, whatever our sex, whatever our education, whatever our financial status, whatever our age, whatever our background or present status is, the power to love is within us. It's the intrinsic nature of the soul. It's so simple. And when that love is imbued with intimacy, Krishna is willing to be conquered by that love. He's longing, he's hungry to be conquered by that love. Satyavrata Muni In his beautiful Damodar Astakam, he offers obeisances to the rope of Yashoda. It is the rope of her love. That love can never be awakened if we try to imitate great souls. But it is awakened when we learn to honor them, to revere them, and to follow in their footsteps. This beautiful vision of Yashoda Mai with a saffron-colored sari, beautifully tying up Krishna, churning the yogurt for Krishna. The vision of Yashoda Mai expressing her love for Gopal is a meditation. We place her feet on our heads. We want to be the servant of the servant of the servant of the servant of the servants of those who love God. And in that mood, Krishna will be pleased to reveal himself to us as with a humble heart, we chant his holy names. Yashoda Mai goes to perform her seva. Krishna's crying because now he's all tied up. But as soon as Yashoda leaves, he stops crying. And he smiles because he had another pastime to perform. He was remembering his beloved devotee Narada Muni. Narada Muni Bajayivi Naradhi Gadamana Name. Narada Muni is so beloved of Krishna because he travels forever, wherever he wishes, always chanting the names of Sri Radhika Raman, the lover of Sri Radha. He saw in the courtyard two Yamala Arjuna trees standing side by side. Now these Arjuna trees are formidable, huge trees. They were so big. They were really, really old. And Arjuna trees, they have a special type of roots, gigantic roots, that make them so strong that even hurricanes and cyclones that knock down every other tree in the forest, the Arjuna trees stand strong. So there were two Arjuna trees. Krishna understood that they were Nalakuvera and Manigriva. Shukadeva Goswami and Srimad Bhagavatam tells a story. They were sons of Kuvera, the treasurer of the devas, and they were devotees of Lord Shiva. They had beautiful celestial bodies, incredible knowledge, and enormous wealth. They were practically infallible, but they were proud. And they were enjoying with some beautiful heavenly ladies, naked in a lake of water. Narada Muni came walking by. The ladies saw, here's a sadhu coming. Narada Muni, a great rishi. And they were very embarrassed, and they got up and covered their bodies with their clothes. But Nala Kuvera and Arjuna just completely ignored Narada Muni. Who cares? They were so intoxicated by their own material prosperity. similar as this morning's talk about Sugriva. When Sugriva was helpless in fear, and he lost everything, he was very, very respectful and attentive to take shelter of Ram. But when he gained his kingdom back, and he had incredible wealth and incredible power and no fears, he forgot. He became overwhelmed by material energy. This material energy is very difficult to overcome. In fact, Queen Kunti prays Janmaishwara Yashutashibir Edamana Madapuman. That when we have great wealth, great fame and beauty and strength and high birth, we can become infatuated. In that infatuation, our heart becomes hardened, and we cannot humbly take shelter of Krishna or chant his name in that spirit. Trinadapi suniche natoror ivasi hishmana. Amani namanadena kirtaniya sadahari. If we want to really access Krishna through our devotional practice or through chanting his names, we have to be willing and eager to offer all respect to others and not expect it for ourselves. Humble like the blade of grass and tolerant and forgiving like a tree. They became so hard-hearted, not because they were bad, but because they were so distracted by worldly pleasures. They became proud. The Bible says pride cometh before the fall. And that's exactly what happened in this story. When we become proud, when we become arrogant, we're already in a fallen condition. Rupan Sanatan Goswami, they reveal to us the highest truths of the spiritual world. But if we want to understand their books, we have to follow in their footsteps. They presented themselves as more fallen than Jagai and Madhai, as the most undeserving and the most sinful, and they were offering all honor and respect to all living beings. When we follow in that path, Krishna reveals through the holy scriptures, through the lives of others, even through the fireworks of Diwali, he will reveal the highest truths to us. And we will be able to actually take shelter of the holy names. So Narada Muni saw their condition and wanted to give them medicine to cure their arrogance. And he blessed them with a curse. Because you are so puffed up, so proud, so intoxicated by your beauty and your strength and your wealth and your knowledge, you're not respecting anybody. The whole world and everything is just centered around you. So selfish, so egocentric. Become trees. What is a tree? You can't move. You just stand there. Nobody's attracted to you. But by Narada's grace, they were trees who, after living for centuries and centuries as trees, totally humbled by the experience, Krishna performed his childhood pastimes, and they were in his courtyard. And even though they had the bodies of immovable trees, they had the same consciousness and awareness as they did as Nala Kuvera and Manigriva. But the apparent pain of what they were going through completely humbled them. So when they saw Krishna's pastimes, they were really attracted. They were really taking shelter. They were falling in love with Krishna. And Krishna saw the trees and remembered Narada, and he crawled. And as he crawled, the grinding mortar that was tied behind him was being dragged. He crawled between the trees, and the grinding mortar got caught between them, and Krishna just pulled slightly with a little crawl, and the trees fell. Millions of times louder than these Diwali fireworks. Everyone in Braj Bhumi, they felt the whole earth shaking like an earthquake. They heard this enormous roaring sound of the trees falling and collapsing to the ground, and they all came running. What happened? Such a great calamity. And there they saw these massive trees laying on the ground on either side, just inches away from little baby Gopal. He was smiling with the grinding mortar tied to his waist. Some of the gopas, the elderly cowherd men, they were asking, what happened, what happened? And the children, they said, we saw what happened. Little Gopal, he started pulling, and he pulled the grinding mortar, and he pulled it between the trees, and the trees fell down. And after the trees fell down, two incredibly effulgent, beautiful personalities came out of the trees. And they described what they looked like. They were demigods, and they had folded palms. They were crying in great happiness, and they were offering prayers to Krishna. And then Krishna blessed them, and they flew up into the sky. Nala Kuvera and Manigriva, they came out of the trees, and they surrendered to Krishna. And in their beautiful prayers, they told how Narada Muni, being such a compassionate devotee, gave them the greatest, most auspicious blessing by humbling themselves so that they could actually appreciate the Lord and develop a true taste for hearing about him and chanting his glories. The cowherd men were thinking, how could little Krishna knock these trees over? Why should we listen to these little children? The little cowherd boys tried to untie the knot, but they couldn't do it because it was tied with Yashoda Mai's motherly love. But Nanda Maharaj, he had fatherly love, Vatsalya Ras. He untied Krishna, and he took Krishna on his lap in a very protective, loving way. Yashoda Mai, along with Rohini, they heard the trees falling. They heard what happened. Yashoda Mai was feeling so guilty. I'm the one who tied up Krishna to the grinding mortar. And look, the danger that I created for Krishna. And Krishna, Nanda Maharaj said to little Gopal, you see, your mother has come for you. And Krishna wanted to increase her affection. He said, I don't want to sit on her lap. I want to stay with you. And he wouldn't even look at Yashoda Mai. And Nanda Maharaj said, why did you tie him up like this? Look at how Krishna is so disturbed with you. And Krishna wouldn't look at her. Nanda Maharaj said, your mother wants you. He said, no, I don't want my mother. Yashodamayi was so heartbroken. She was weeping, crying. And Rohini came to Krishna and told, "What is your mother's condition?" And Krishna jumped off Nanda Maharaja's lap and went running to Yashodamayi, "Mata, mata, mata." And she came running to Krishna and they embraced. And at that time, she resumed with feeding Krishna the milk of her love. This is Vrindavan. In the Padma Purana, Satyavrat Muni, in his conversation with Narada Muni and Sonaka Rishi, has composed these eight prayers. In one prayer, "O Lord, although you are able to give all kinds of benedictions, I do not pray to you for the boon of impersonal liberation, nor the highest liberation of eternal life in Vaikuntha, the spiritual world, nor any other boon. O Lord, I simply wish that this form of yours, as Balgopal in Vrindavan, may ever be manifest in my heart. For what is the use to me of any other boon besides this? O Lord, your lotus face, which is encircled by locks of soft black hair tinged with red, is kissed again and again by Mother Yashoda, and your lips are reddish like the bimba fruit. May this beautiful vision of your lotus face be ever manifest in my heart. Thousands and thousands of other benedictions are of no use to me." The story of Diwali and the story of the Damodar Lila are reminders to us. Bhaktya Twananyaya Shakya Aham Evam Vidurjuna. Krishna tells in Gita, only by pure love, bhakti, can I be known as I am. Can I be seen in my Satchidananda form? The greatest benediction Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and all of the great acharyas and saints and devotees prayed for is Prema Pumartha Mahan, this love. Sri Ramanujacharya, Madhvacharya, Vallabhacharya, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, all their associates, they taught us that there is no higher, no more treasured goal to strive for than the awakening of this love that is within our hearts. Srila Prabhupada, he saw that potential within all of us. And he had complete faith that all the powers, nam nam akari bahuda nija sarva shaktis, all the power and the beauty and the attraction of Krishna is within the name. And by sincerely chanting these names in a spirit of unselfish, loving service, this love is awakened. We come on these yatras to inspire one another, to empower one another with faith and enthusiasm to seek this love. Thank you very much.